Okay, shalom lekulam. Hello everyone. So today we are going to do a Kubernetes workshop. You don't need any prerequisite background or something like that. You have the small white notes that we put on the tables, and you can use them to log in to a Kubernetes terminal. This will allow you to run the different commands that we will have during the workshop. So, yes, so this is the slide for the Wi-Fi, and you should try to connect. I'm using another one. So it's working for me. The OpenStack is also working, but this is a dedicated Wi-Fi for the workshops only. The passwords and the short URL for the presentation. You will need the presentation because the workshop commands are documented in the presentation. You will be able to find the link to the presentation as well in the workshop folder in the EC2 instance that you will log in for everyone who's using the terminal. So anybody else that need a username and password to log into the system? Okay, so if someone needs one, let us know and we will give you one to log in. So we are done with the Wi-Fi. So my name is Liran Cohen. I am leading the cloud platform and DevOps team at LivePerson. And today we are going to talk about Kubernetes. So Kubernetes, let's understand where Kubernetes got the name. So the originate is from Greek. And the meaning of the word is like helmsman or pilot. Basically, it's the one holding the wheel or steering the wheel of the ship. So basically what Kubernetes is trying to do. So what is it Kubernetes? Kubernetes is a cluster container manager. The idea is to deliver a platform that can help us automate our deployments, scales, and do a very reasonable operations around our applications. More facts about Kubernetes is that it's originate at Google. They are claiming that they are doing this one like more than 10 years now, and they have a system named Borg. You should expect Kubernetes to support the major cloud provider, which is like today I'm familiar with good integration with Amazon, of course Google Cloud, and even there are drivers for OpenStack for any on-premise solution cloud that wants to integrate Kubernetes. We can close the door so we will have some more quiet around here. Thank you. More facts about Kubernetes. You can run multiple container runtime. Anyone familiar with Docker? You can also use Rocket from CoreOS as the runtime container engine. It's an open source project. The main leaders are Google developers, but I know a lot of Red Hat contribution around Kubernetes because of the OpenShift platform or PaaS solution. It's written in Go. Most of the container ecosystem today are written in Go, Docker in Go, and more solution from CoreOS. So K8S, you will see it all over the place. It's a shortcut for Kubernetes. The idea is that it will replace the 8 letters of the between the K and the S. So the most important one is that we are going to manage application containers and not machines. So this is the main one to take here. So why do we need Kubernetes? It's very easy to take a single tier application, deploy it. We have one server, two servers, easily managed. No, it's not such a fun, but it's possible. When we go into multi-tier application, it's still something we can do. You can do it with configuration management, with some dependencies, but you will get some of your application or multi-tier application working and deployable. But when you have lots of them, like microservices, you need more. You need an easy way to scale, an easy way to upgrade, an easy way to operate. You need an easy way to discover every piece of your microservices. And this is why you need Kubernetes. And you can do it with Docker and Kubernetes. If you need more info, why do you need Kubernetes, even if it's something that you should look at? You have more info from the Google website in the link. Some of the architecture of Kubernetes. We will review this architecture quickly and see that we understand the basic components that we need to run Kubernetes. So of the main component, which is the control plane. If you can see, the control plane has several components that you can easily scale this layer. You have an etcd layer for the persistent key value storage. You have the API, which is the entry point to the cluster. All the tools that are running against the cluster will use this API endpoint. We will get to know kubectl command line for Kubernetes, which is the CLI working against this API server. We have the scheduler. This is the mechanism for the decision on which compute object or which container, and we will soon see what is a pod, which pod should be scheduled to which host. And the last one is the controller manager. Controller manager is the component which currently has more than one functionality, and according to the Kubernetes documentation, they are all different binaries that currently they are compiled in one place, but eventually they are going to split them in order to make a scalable control plane. But the controller manager, and we need to learn that the controller manager is responsible of different functionality. If it's managing the nodes, we will learn about replication controller and why do we need a controller manager to watch these components, the endpoints, which is part of the service object, and more. We have a service account. We are not going to talk about all these components, but it's good to know that we have the controller manager that is doing some of the heavy lifting in the control plane. Moving on to the other part of this architecture of Kubernetes, we have the compute. So the compute is where you actually have the container engine installed, which is, in our case, we are talking about Docker. And you have two Kubernetes components, which are the service proxy and kubelet. Kubelet, the main idea behind the kubelet is to have like all the heavy lifting of Kubernetes that you need to do with the Docker containers is done through the kubelet. And the service proxy is the service that will allow us to get the traffic to our pod or to our endpoint resource. So service proxy, you can think about this as a distributed load balancer solution. So we can get traffic to the end compute. Okay, so we talked about the node. Now we are going to review different types of components in the system. We talked about nodes. So node, as we can see, is the one that we are going to schedule our resources on this unit, which we will soon learn what is a pod. We have, and eventually we are here in the pod. So pod is the smallest, is a small group of tightly coupled containers. And basically, they can share some volume between them. So you can think of a pod as like a logical aggregation of one or more containers. So we can see in this diagram that we have a pod. And this pod has two containers. One container will run like a file puller functionality to get some content from the from some, I don't know, Git repo, something like that. The second one will be a web server, which in an Nginx for this for our example, and they will share a volume. And this pod will be scheduled with one or more replicas to different compute in our systems. So when we are talking about pod, all of the container in the same pod will share some resources. One of them is the network IP address, so they can reach each other in local and a loop device. So they can share traffic through the local host interface, and they will have a unique IP for the pod. All the container inside the pod will see the same IP address. You should see that when you are managing pods, pod will be scheduled to one of the hosts, and that's it. You will, the life cycle will end on that same host. You can delete one, and the system will create another one, but it will never be a pod that was moved from one compute to another. Like, I don't know, VM live migration, if someone is using this functionality. So we talked about the pod, and the, in the exercise we will see this. We will do an exercise that will simulate exactly this type of pod. Moving on, you can see that Kubernetes wants us to say, how do we want to create the objects that we need? It's like a declarative approach. We will say to Kubernetes using a YAML format, or it could be a JSON one, which version of the API we want to use, which type of resource we want to create. For example, for our example is we want to create a pod, and we want to put some labeling on the pod, some metadata that will help us find find this pod in the system, easily discoverable. And Kubernetes will use this labeling for some of the functionality that we will learn as part of the system. So the main part is the spec. In the spec, we are going to declare what is the status or what is the state that we want to achieve, or we want Kubernetes, what we want from the system to put our pod in which state. So we will tell Kubernetes we want a spec of pod that has a name, my first pod, and in the specification we'll describe which kind of containers and volumes or anything else related to pod resources that we want the system to create for us. So the spec will be, we want one container called file puller. Remember from the last example, we will have file puller, the image name of the file puller, it's the Docker image. We will use file puller from repository, from my repository, as SD1C. We have a volume mount, which is the shared volume between the containers. And the next container will be a web server container that will share the same volume as well. So one container, the file puller, we get some code, some of the static content from the internet, and we'll save it on the volume, and the Nginx, our web server, will serve this content to the end user. Labels. Using labels, we saw labels in the metadata section. So using labels, we can easily, label is a key value pair object metadata. We can easily label our attached some metadata objects on the different Kubernetes objects. It can be pod, service, replication controller, etc. So you can see in this case, what we did, we put three type of key value labels. One will say, what is the role of my pod? The second one will say, what is the phase? It can be like a staging pod, it can be a production one. The last one, we can use the name to say, what's the name of the pod? And we will be easily will be able to query the different kind of pods, replication controller in the system. So it's very easy to find and use that one. Another one, which is very important for the functionality of Kubernetes, is selectors. Using selectors, we can ask Kubernetes to select or to aggregate a group of pods in order to do some of the functionality that we need. So selector is a very simple query. We're going to say, if we have a selector name my first pod, all the pods that have the label with the name my first pod will be queried and returned as a result for this query. And we will see how we are going to declare this selector and use it in Kubernetes and also in the command line to find the different resources that are relevant for our search. So replication controller. Replication controller is a very simple mechanism, and the main role of replication controller is to keep the state of the number of replication that we have in the system. So let's say we have the pod that we talked about earlier, and we want to keep four replicas from that pod. So we will have four replicas. Each pod will have two containers. One will pull data from the internet. The other one will serve it to the end user. And we are going to say to the replication controller, what you need to do, you need to use the selector to see which pod you need to watch or to keep them up or down if it's necessary. And the other one is the number of replicas that you need to maintain in the system. So if we have, like, from some reason, five pods running, the replication controller mechanism will decide that you need to terminate one of the pods and move on to the and so on. You can use the same if you have like a few number of pods. Let's say one of the servers needs some maintenance and we decided to drain that server. The replication controller mechanism will identify that we have less than four replicas in the system and will do and will schedule the pods required to get to the main goal of the replication controller is to have a X current pods equal the X desired pod. So this is the replication controller, and this is how we can manage the different pods in the system. Services. So services are very similar to load balancing mechanism or a VIP. So you can have a service that will move traffic to the different pod in the system. You need to remember that these pods are all over the place. You have different servers running different pods, and some component needs to watch the different pod and make sure the traffic which arrives to that VIP goes to the pods. And in our case, we can see that if we are going to run the first pod, we need some service that will move traffic to the pod so the end user can consume this content. Going to the virtual IP, we have several options. One of the options is to create a service with internal IP. Internal IP in Kubernetes will be available only in the Kubernetes cluster. Each pod in the system will be able to address this IP, and the virtual IP will send the traffic to the relevant pod. But if we want to expose, for example, our web server, we want to expose it outside, we need something we need to add external IP, and we have different type of external IP. Two of them are node port or load balancer type. The idea is to have the host listen to this IP to a range of IPs that we declare, and we will see an example in the exercise. And that way we can get the traffic coming from outside and routed to the different pod that we have in the system. So that's the service, and we need to think about this like a load balancer or some distributed load balancing mechanism for accessing the pod. What? Which one? The virtual IPs? They are running on the proxy mechanism that we saw earlier. So if you have this service proxy on each one of the hosts, you will use, it depends on the mode that you are working. I have the backup slide that describe a user space mode, bus IP table modes, and it depends. But basically, this on each compute will make sure that when you arrive and or when you are asking this, the service will redirect you to the relevant pod. We can see one of the examples in the backup slides. This one, you can see that if you are going to user space, then the kube proxy will forward your request to the different pod, okay? And if you are in IP table mode, you will get kube proxy manipulate some of the IP table rules, so you will get routed to the relevant pod. So it's happening on each one of the nodes. This is why I told you that it's like a distributed load balancing mechanism. So it's kind of. So we talked about service, and the service YAML declaration is very similar to the pod, and we can review this together. The same requirements for each one of the resources in Kubernetes is to provide the API version. If you want to, you have to provide the type of the resource. Currently, it's a service resource that we are going to create in the system. Metadata that we already talked about, and the specification, the desired state we want to achieve, that we want Kubernetes to give us. So in this case, we are saying to Kubernetes, we want to create a service that is target port. The endpoint of the container will be port 80. The port that the internal IP will listen will be port 80. So we are directing from service IP 80 to target IP in the container, which it's also the same port in this case. And the selector one is the critical one to understand here, because we talked about the selector in replication controller. The replication controller will choose which pod it needs to monitor using the selector. Same goes for the service. The service needs to know which type of pod should get the traffic coming to this endpoint. And once the client will go to the virtual IP, which is the service will forward the request to one of the pods that he managed to select in the selector query. Config map is a new resource coming from version, I think, 1.2 of Kubernetes, and it's very, very useful, at least for what we saw. Config map is the way to decouple your image content in Docker. You have an immutable image, and you need to keep your configuration outside of the image because you want the image or the container to be really portable for any environment. So the configuration should be on an environment level, and that we can achieve that way, that our image is really something that we can take from one environment to another, if it's like from QA, or from QA to staging, to alpha, to production, to the public cloud. We can use the same image with the same YAML declaration, and using the config map, we can inject the relevant configuration for each environment. So you can see in this simple example, we are using one of the resources of config map, which is called default app, and we have only one key value. The key value that we want to achieve is like an environment variable that we are calling DB host, the key value, and we can consume in the pod the value from the config map resource. It's very, very, very handy, and I know that a lot of people are looking for such a configuration. We have another one, the big brother of config map, which is called Secret. Secret is more for keeping secrets, and this is why it's the older brother. So secrets will, if you need to keep database passwords, you need to keep certificates, please use secrets and not config map for this configuration. Namespace, will, this is a mechanism to have multi-tenancy. You're probably familiar with multi-tenancy in OpenStack, so you are getting similar functionality in Kubernetes. And today, if someone will do the exercise, you will see that each one of the people that will run the different application will have a dedicated namespace. So we don't need to create a dedicated cluster for each one of the users. That's it for the introduction. Now we are going to do the CLI basics. I will do it also. And everyone with a computer working with SSH, that's the only requirement, can do the exercise as well. So we will start. Anyone need help? So we can have, we have people that can help here. So if something is not working, feel free to tell us. So we created the workshop, so everyone that can connect to his username and password will get all the relevant content of the workshop available in the home user. So it's very easy. You can go to K8S workshop, and we can start with the CLI demo. Did you get like the white note?
Can you please share once again the link to the presentation?
Yes. You are connected. You are already connected. You have the link inside the, you see the workshop. Okay, you need the link. It must be easier for you to see it over here. Okay? Okay, so now we are going to learn the kubectl command line for Kubernetes, which is a very, very powerful command line tool. So after you manage to log in to our instance, you have Kubernetes available for you. Just go to the folder KTS underscore workshop, to the CLI underscore demo directory, and there we will have all the resources that we need for this exercise. So the basic commands are, of course, if you need some help, you can get help on each one of the commands. And the nice thing here is that when you get the help section has some examples, which is very helpful. You can see the version of the system, the client version and the server side version, very similar to Docker. If you want to get more cluster information, you can see the endpoint of the cluster of your different system available or services available inside Kubernetes. Kubernetes will give you some add-ons that you can add for metrics, logging, and more to manage your applications. So this one will be listed here. Every time you install a new service in the cluster, you will see it available in cluster info. Moving to the kubectl, you can see too many commands, right? So we will probably use the most common ones. So this is how we are going to create the resource. So you remember the my first pod, YAML, that we described earlier. You can easily get kubectl create and create this resource. So let's say I want to create, everyone that are using the demo should create all the resources in the system. Sorry, I will to create. One second. Okay, great. So I need to go here and here. This one working. Okay, so I managed to create the first one. The first one is by file name. The second one we can create. We can give an entire folder with YAMLs, and it will create all the resources in that directory, which is easy one. You can use an stdin to create a resource, and you can even create a resource from a URL, which is very cool and very useful. So you need to do all of the commands in the system in order to get the the YAML files are located in KTS workshop in each home directory of each user in the CLI demo. So I will make sure this one is bigger, okay? So we managed to create the different resources in the system. The first resource that we created was the My First Pod, which is a pod. The second one was more than one resource that was in the directory RC Web. We have a service and a replication controller running inside this folder, inside this directory. The third one was the create a resource from stdin. We created the service. Remember the service, the load balancer? For us, that then we created the service. And the last one will be to create from the URL. We are creating a new pod to test the log mechanism of Kubernetes later on in the exercise. Yes. What? What? The one that I showed you earlier in the presentation, right? This one? This is the content of the file. This is how you specify what's the state or what, which resource that you want to create using the kubectl command line. Yes. What?
The stdin doesn't work.
I just tried it. So maybe you forgot to put them the last
minus?
Yes, the last minus. This is one for stdin. It's not working? So back to the create section. Okay, so we have different resources, different type of resources that was created on the system. So everyone that tried will soon see the different resources available for him. So let's try the, if you're going to say kubectl get, you will see which one of the resources available in Kubernetes that you can list. So let's list all the pods in your environment. So if I will say kubectl get pods, I will see all the pods that we created earlier in the create command, right? So I have one log me pod, one my first pod, and two pods that were created with the replication controller that we will review later. You can get a wide output, which is nice. You can see which pod landed on which node. So if you want to know where is your pod was scheduled to, you can see it in the wide example. And you can also have a wide YAML format for the status of your pod. Moving on to the get, we can see that we have we talked about label and selectors, so we can definitely use the option to query the different type of resources in the system. So we are going to tell Kubernetes, give us all the pods with the name RC web pod, and we will get two pods answering this label. If you want to describe, to list more than one type of resources, you can do it like that, and we will get the information, all the pods and all the services that we created in the system. Okay, let's go to the fun stuff. Describe will give us some information. Okay, we have more information that we need to know on a specific pod, right? We want to know all the events that were done during the pod allocation and creation. We have the IP address of the pod, all the labels, the Docker image, all the information that we need, we can find in Describe, and Describe will work on each one of the components in the system, so we can describe the service as well. So now that we want to check if it's working for us, we can describe the service, and we can see, as I mentioned earlier, there are some services that we want to expose outside. Okay, so what we did in this exercise, we exposed the my first pod to the internet, and we got from our cloud provider this URL. So each one of you should have this URL available, different one, because you have a different deployment environment. And once you will go to your browser, if it was already published to the internet DNS, you will see that the website is working. And you remember that we explained about the file pooler, that we are going to change some static content in GitHub, and we will see the change in our pod, so we can try it. What? Okay. 1 second. Exceeded quota in the cluster? Oh, shit. So this is the Amazon fault. I will delete mine. Okay, if you go to the CLI demo, and we have this file pooler, some content in the index.html file. Let's try to change something, and we will hope the demo is working. So we have the welcome. Mm-hmm. If you want to search this here, welcome, we will change it to static. For example, we will save it. And maybe it's going to work. Let's wait. So the file pooler should pull this content on any, I don't remember the interval, but this should be modified. Okay, working. So I changed the code in the GitHub, the pod, the container which is responsible for pulling the data, did what he was born to do, and he pulled the data from GitHub, and we can see that we have the static page available for us. So let's move on to okay, so we talked about describing the different resources, and we can describe a node as well. So if we get the nodes, this is all the nodes that we have in the system. This is the Kubernetes nodes compute, which are running the kubelet and kubeproxy. We can get one of them, and see if we got some containers running on them, on the node. So this is the list of containers running currently on this node, and you can have more information about the capacity of the node, the version, the agents, and the status, and more, it's very useful command. Going to the log, so you have different containers running all over the place, and you want to see the log, the logs of your application. So basically, if you are familiar with Docker, you need to log in to the Docker server where the Docker engine is running. You need to find the name of the container, and then you can use the log command. Kubectl will allow you to get any log in the system, no matter where your pod is scheduled, on which host it was scheduled. So I'm asking the system, give me all the logs of LogMe pod, and I will get the logs, and I can stream the logs as well. I can do a logs stream and listen to the logs, and if I will mention the P flag, I will get the logs of my previous container. This is very good for troubleshooting. The last command is if we have a pod with more than one container, and we want to see the different log on each container, we have to specify the name of the controller. If you want specified, I think it will yell and will say, okay, give me one of them. And I'm going to give him the file pooler, and we'll see that we are syncing data from the GitHub every X minutes, every X seconds, I think. So after we did the log mechanism, we saw the log subcommands, we have more nice stuff that we can use to manage our application. One of them is the scale. We talked about the replication controller and the ability of the replication controller to give us more than one replica in the system, right? So let's say we have a replication controller that we deployed earlier, and this replication controller will have is watching over two pods. And we want to make sure that we have more. We want to tell the replication controller, hey, sorry, we need three replication controllers, three replicas of this pod. The reason we put some three is because we have a we have some capacity limitation in the cluster. So we have three replication controllers running. And we can easily scale it back to two replicas. Sorry. You can see it's going to be terminated. צריך לחשוב על מים לפני זה, כן? טוב. Okay, so let's continue. We can inject any commands that we want to an existing container. It's very easy. You use the exec command and you will get a bash running inside the container. You can look around. You don't see, you are not going to see much. This is the command that we are running inside the container, the logmesh. And that's it. Let's log out from the container. The second one is an example and how you can inject a command to a specific container when we have more than one container in a pod. So we are going to specify the container very similar to the way we did with the logs, okay? So after What do you mean? So basically, you have containers as part of the pod, the number of containers, and you want to see how much containers that you have on each VM. Yeah. So you can do it. Let's see, 1 second. Let's describe the node. You can see here on each VM the different pod of the system. And if you have the pod, it's easily going to give you, you can easily get the containers on each pod. So each pod will have one or more containers. Most use cases will have one. And you can easily query the system and ask if you have, you can describe the pod. And if you describe the pod, you will see which containers are running inside this pod, okay? No, so you can have multiple replica of the same pod on different node, but once you have one pod, it will be created on a specific host, and all the containers that we ask to create as part of the pod will be created only on this pod, okay? So they are tightly coupled, scheduled together, containers from the same pod. Okay, so that is very cool, okay? We deploy it easily. You know, we don't need to install machines, run configuration management, wait for Puppet to pull RPM, et cetera, et cetera. And we have dependencies, binaries, which are not working. Everything is working. You have a immutable image executed as a Docker container. Kubernetes is making sure you have this working and the traffic traveling to the right place. And you can easily scale, and you don't need to think about the operating system running beneath your containers. And you want to move to the first, to the next level of let's upgrade the system. So we want to upgrade our system. So remember that we created something that we call our application controller, RC Web. This was in the section of the create. So let's check if this one is available for us. So I will describe the web, and I will see that this is the web endpoint that I got from the system. So this is the replication controller. We have two pods running. The replication controller is working and running two pods. And we have a service that will move traffic to these pods. And you can see this is my version one of the application. This is the first time I'm building a replication controller on Kubernetes, and my pod name is RC Web and some digits and numbers and alphanumeric strings that Kubernetes will generate automatically. So if we will refresh the page, maybe we are lucky to see that we got the second pod, okay? So it will, you will see that if we'll do some, maybe we will get back to the last one. So we have two pods, and the load balancer will give the work to one of them. And now we want to upgrade. You know that upgrades are not so much fun, right? So we can easily upgrade the system. Let's say we have a new version, V2, which are much, much more full of bugs. And we need to upgrade to this version. So we are using a kubectl rolling update mechanism. We are going to upgrade our replication controller. And we are going to say to the replication controller, you have a new image. The image name is RCWeb V2. And I want you to update each pod every 10 seconds. And when I will click on this one, I will see that Kubernetes will start to replace the different pod with the new image. And if we will go to the link, we should see that we move to RC V2. Okay, we managed to upgrade our system in very fast, yes, it was like seconds. And it's still working. The new pod is working. It will bring one pod from the new version, make sure it's running, delete the old one, create a new one, until he will get the desired state that we told him, which is the two replicas available in the system. Moving on, so kubectl edit is very nice. So you have a resource already available in a system, in the system, and you want to edit the current state. So you can use the edit, and you will get a very nice editor which will do a validation for your mistakes. And for this example, we can easily modify mutable fields only. There are some immutable fields that you can't update. So if we will update this replication, and we are lucky enough, we will see that we have the third one coming because we edit the replication controller mechanisms, very similar to the scale command that we did earlier. And the last one is, let's delete everything and we can go home. So delete my first pod, nice. I'm going to delete my services easily. And this is much more fun. We are going to delete all pods. Cool. The last one, replication controller, because you remember that if we delete the pod and we have a replication controller working, you will have a new pods running in the system because you deleted the pod and not the replication controller. And the job of the replication controller is to keep you with the desired number of replicas of pod running in the system. So if we will say, we will see that kubectl get pod, we will see that we didn't actually delete all the pods. Again, deleting, terminating, creating a new one. If we want to delete replication controller mechanism, we have to delete the replication controller itself. So everyone is in the termination phase, and we will soon see we have no pods or any resources in the system. Okay, Kubernetes has a nice dashboard that you can install as an add-on, and you will see it available in the cluster info. You can do some stuff in the dashboard, create replication controller, create pods and services, very nice UI that you can interact with. There are some more third-party dashboard solution. I have one installed called Fabricate. And we will try to see if it's working for me. So in Fabricate, I can see all the namespaces in the system. Remember that all of you got the white notes. So we created a namespace for each of the users in the workshop. And I just deleted all my environment, so I won't see something special here. But if I will create, if I will try to create this one, for example, I should see some nice diagram of the, okay. Now I will see I have a new pod and I can easily access the pod. And it's a very nice one. If someone is looking for a friendly UI to manage Kubernetes, you should take a look at Fabricate. The last part, much time do we have? Okay, we have like 3 minutes. So the plan was to do a workshop, not only the basic CLI. This workshop is available at the Kubernetes repository. So you have the link and you can try it yourself. It's very nice one. You are creating a service, pods, And another layer, this is a multi-tier application with a PHP front-end and a Redis master and Redis slave for content persistency. And you can easily try it yourself. Here are the commands. You have the slides. So we came for OpenStack, and we want to talk about like at least one slide about OpenStack and Kubernetes and the relationship between them. So if you want to achieve Kubernetes installed on OpenStack, you have more than one option. So you have more than one option. One option is using Murano. I'm not sure about the maturity of this project, so if someone has any input about that, I will be happy to hear more. Magnum, it's a very nice framework for hosting different type of container management cluster solution. It can be Swarm, it can be Kubernetes or Mesos solution. I think this is the three I'm aware of. And earlier in the talk of CERN, they talked about they are already running Magnum to give some container capabilities in their cloud. You can easily do it with configuration management tools similar to Puppet, Ansible, Salt, etc. I think Salt is also supported as part of the Kubernetes repository. We are using Puppet. For example, we have Puppet running and deploying all the Kubernetes cluster that we are currently running at LivePerson. We talked about the integration with the cloud. So OpenStack has Kubernetes. Someone from the community developed a cloud driver for OpenStack. So you can consume resources from your OpenStack cloud service running. You can have block storage available for Kubernetes, and also load balancing as a service solution available, similar to the way that we got this solution from Amazon when we created a new service in the system, and Amazon did all the magic in the background and gave us a URL for to access our service. And you can also install Kubernetes with Kubernetes. There is an option. It's very the one are using that are CoreOS. You can Kubelet is the resource that we are managing the compute in Kubernetes, and you can easily put all the YAMLs in one folder of your Kubernetes, and Kubernetes will deploy itself using Kubelet. If you are talking on the other side of the relationship between Kubernetes and OpenStack, you can install OpenStack using Kubernetes. There are some, if someone is familiar with Kola is an OpenStack project that its goal is to easily deploy OpenStack using containers. So this is the next level. The next level is going to say I'm not going to install my OpenStack with a simple container solution with some automation and scripts. Let's use Kubernetes. Kubernetes will know how to do a good container or container management for us. So we can easily deploy. In the future, we will be able to deploy OpenStack using Kubernetes. And you can see there is a CoreOS project as part of the Tectonic Kubernetes distribution by CoreOS, which you can use to deploy OpenStack on Kubernetes. So there is a video of Alex from CoreOS from the last OpenStack Summit in Austin, Texas, showing the deployment of OpenStack using Kubernetes, and they are and it's very fun to watch because this is a nice approach. This is going to say Kubernetes is also some type of configuration management that we are using today, like Puppet or something similar to that. So that's it. If you have more questions, This is the time.
Production OpenStack on Kubernetes?
No.
Okay.
So it's very, very, very new project, and it will take some time for us, but I think this is a very good approach. It will be for us as a private cloud in scale, it will be very easy for us to scale our control plane, which is very difficult for us today. We are working very hard. You probably heard CERN working very hard on upgrades, on scale of components. So this can be very, very, very good for us. And if you have some experience with OpenStack, sometimes you are wasting a lot of time on package binaries dependencies. This is like in Python, you can waste like a weeks until something is working as expected. So getting this image ready, an immutable image ready, tested, running your API Neutron, API Nova, API Cinder, and easily upgradable, tested by the community, it's much, much, much more powerful than the usual traditional puppet working in the lab, not working in production, etc. Okay, more?
What kind of isolation?
So currently, I know they are still developing the different type of isolation, but you can get some of the quota per namespace, and some policies will be available for you to enforce in a namespace level. Currently, the namespace that we deployed is like there is no isolation for. So we didn't for this demo we don't need any isolation. You can do, there is some plugins for authentication, authorization for namespace, etc. So I think it will be much more mature in later versions. Yes.
The proxy.
Yes.
It's a proxy.
No. Currently, it's based on a component as part of Kubernetes, which is called kubeproxy, which is doing some manipulation to IP tables. So there is a feature called ingress, which is available in Kubernetes to get the traffic inside your cluster. You should check it. I don't have much experience with that because we are currently evaluating this one. And the current naive solution of the load balancer, the one that I showed, is that you can do a round robin between the pods. You don't have any sophisticated list connection or something like that. You have a round robin, and lately, in the last version, I think they added client IP affinity. So you will get the same client on the same pod each time. And I know that in the next version coming out soon, they will support cookie affinity or something like that. More features are going in this direction.
What do you use to monitor? Because it's different. Usually I monitor servers, loaded, CPU,
So this is a tricky one, yes? So you need to think about applications, stop thinking about servers, but as a sysadmin, you should still monitor your servers and your application. And the way you can monitor is with different metrics coming from the application and from the servers. So this one is built in Kubernetes. There is something called cAdvisor and Hipster, which is part of Kubernetes distribution. And cAdvisor will give you all the metrics that you need in the container level. And Hipster will collect all this data from all the nodes and can save it for you in, for example, for this example, you have like an InfluxDB. You will put all the data in the time series database, and you can easily use Grafana to query the different nodes, pods, and you can have any custom metrics that you want. There is another project. If you want like more application metrics that you want to monitor, call the Prometheus, which is aiming for the application container monitoring capabilities that we need.
The last one, if I'm running out of capacity on the node, I have like three nodes, yes. The load is getting too high. Kubernetes has some ability to...
Yes, so we didn't have time to show it. There is an autoscale mechanism. I also have a nice video that will that can show you how it easily can autoscale. You are going to set up a rule. Currently, you have in the last version, you have like you can set the CPU or memory as the rule of the autoscaling mechanism. And once you hit the threshold, it will automatically create a new pod for you. Node. Node, Kubernetes is not aiming to manage itself on the underlay. If you want, if you need more nodes from your cloud provider, the way to do it is you have Amazon deployment mechanism, and so you can do it with Heat and the alarming system of OpenStack. So depends on where you deploy it. If it's a bare metal, or you need to run to the data center and put more servers in the rack. So Kubernetes is not aiming to deal with this layer, only the application container level above. Okay? Okay, so I think our time is up. And if there are no more questions, we are done for today. Thank you very much.